So I'll just bring out speaker notes. I think that's it. Sorry. Maybe I can hit it. There we go. Just figured it out.
You back on?
Cool. Yeah, let's do it. Are you streaming this?
Yes. I'm trying to.
So how you guys are streaming it is you're just hitting space when I do?
Yeah.
Along with my vocals?
Yeah, from that mic.
That's how you guys have... Okay. I mean, whatever works, right? Whatever works. How many viewers do you have live stream?
We had 6 before. And I'm trying to see if the stream will even play.
Thanks. Yeah, I know. Hitting the big times here.
Is the stream back on?
Yeah. Are you guys monetizing this? You guys, you know?
I mean,
yes, I gave a presentation like a year ago. Yeah. No, lower your expectations. Lower them. Look at that. I don't even have a title, okay? I just have one word as my presentation. Dude, it's minimalistic, okay? There's a style to this, okay? There's a style here. You know? Radio. Yeah, exactly. It's like what Steve Jobs would do. Just minimalistic. Just one word. All you need. I should have worn a turtleneck, you're right. But, are we good?
Yeah. I'm just going to share the link again because it changed channels every time we restart.
Awesome. Hello, everybody. Hello, everybody. Yes, thank you. I'm Adam, and welcome to my presentation about radio. Who am I? A lot of you guys in the room know who I am, but I've graduated from ISS. I work as a consultant at Deloitte. And if you're looking for a job, come talk to me, because I'm the official campus recruiter for Sheridan Deloitte. So yeah, come talk to me. So before I continue, a bit of a disclaimer about radio. If you are broadcasting on frequencies that you're not supposed to be broadcasting, it is super, super illegal. People will find you, people will hunt you down, and, you know, try to arrest you. So, you know, before you do anything with radio, do look into it yourself. So I'm not a lawyer, so, you know, try to be careful with what you're doing. So I created this presentation as a bit of an introduction to radio. About a year ago, I became super passionate about radio. I watched a whole bunch of DEF CON videos. And my issue was when you Google ham radio, is all the links that you receive are all for American ham radio. Very, very little of that information is relevant to us as Canadians. So I've done the hard work. I found the links, and I'll you know, present that to you guys here. So what even is radio? What are we talking about here? So essentially, radio is communication through leveraging electromagnetic energy waves. And why do we care about radio? Well, it's used pretty well everywhere on the planet. It's used in planes, trains, automobiles. It's your Wi-Fi. It's your Bluetooth. But the coolest thing about radio is the fact that it works without infrastructure. You know, if you and I want to communicate, all we need to do is go and buy radios, and we have that direct link. Consider that compared to networks and the amount of infrastructure you need to communicate over that and the internet. So radio, very cool stuff. So just for reference, here is the entire electromagnetic spectrum here. Obviously, we are just operating in that tiny niche there, radio. So yeah, cool stuff right here. But what is ham, right? What is ham radio? So ham radio is essentially just amateur radio. You know, so if you look at this, yes, this is a radio. So amateur radio is essentially just a fraction of that radio spectrum dedicated to amateur use. A lot of the radio spectrum is dedicated to, you know, critical infrastructure like fire, police, things of that nature. And a small little bit of it is just for the average, you know, amateur. So why is it called ham in the first place? A lot of people, you know, really don't know. Ham was actually a word that used to be a derogatory term for amateur use. And they took it back, amateurs. They took back the phrase ham radio because it used to be an insult. And what about SDR? So SDR just stands for Software Defined Radio. And you can consider this essentially just taking radio hardware and abstracting it into a software layer. Essentially, this is you are emulating radio hardware on your computer, and that's that. I should note as well that if you aren't licensed to use amateur radio frequencies, you will also be fined and potentially arrested for your usage, so do be careful. And because software-defined radio is just regular radio abstracted on a computer, you can also get arrested through SDR as well, so do be careful with this stuff. But the most interesting thing about amateur radio is the fact that the CIA triangle that we know and love practically doesn't exist. So for amateur radio anyway, you're not allowed to use encryption, and if you do use encryption, you have to publish the key, which kind of defeats the whole purpose of you using encryption to begin with. On top of that, steganography is a bit of a gray area. Obviously, the whole point of steganography is the fact that, you know, you're supposed to hide that from people. So if people don't know you're using steganography, how can they really, you know, get you for that? On top of that, no authentication. See, with ham radio, when you get your license, you're given a call sign, which is essentially identifies you as the person. And that is a bit of authentication, but there's no way to prove that you are the person you say you are. So it's completely unlike our regular networking world where we can cryptographically prove, you know, you are who you say you are and things of that nature. I did find one article, though, about trying to implement PKI, or public key infrastructure, through radio usage. Although, it didn't make any sense to me, and I feel like I have a firm background in PKI, and it was like the stupidest idea you can think of. Like, imagine on a radio, you are just saying a list of letters, and the person on the other end is trying to write that down and record that, and then use a computer with your known public key to verify that. It was a bit of a crazy idea. Thankfully, that's not being implemented in any regard, but yeah, stupid idea. No, I have no idea what they were thinking. They also thought about using MD5 hashes as well, along with the message. Look, it didn't make any sense to me, and oh man, I can share the article if you guys want to read it, but it just doesn't make any sense. So on top of that, with radio, you have no integrity as well. Anywhere after you broadcast your message, that message can be changed, and there's nothing you can really do about it. It's out of your hands. And on top of that, no availability as well. With computers, we have plenty of redundancy. But after you say your message, that's pretty much it. If nobody hears it, nobody hears it. If you're getting attacked by bears and you're saying, help me, and nobody hears that, you're pretty much bear food. So yeah, be careful out there. And here's my excellent post-production design here. So what can you do with ham radio and amateur radio? Well, you can literally save the world here. For instance, in the months past, the hurricanes that have ravaged Puerto Rico and Texas and all that, the American Red Cross actually broadcasted that they're looking for amateur ham radio operators to come down to Puerto Rico, spend 4 to 6 weeks, and actually help build the country back. Because radio doesn't rely on really anything to operate, you know, it's really helpful when you're in those kind of disaster situations. So it's great. On top of that, you can also use ham radio to communicate with satellites as well. So if you want to become a Bond villain and create the next GoldenEye, you can, you know, you can do that as well. So you can either save the world or destroy it with ham radio. Up to you guys. You know, that kind of stuff. But obviously you guys came here for the security stuff. So let's talk security. By the way, this is a hilarious video if you've never seen it before. Mega64's Deus Ex video. Absolutely hilarious. Go check it out. But yeah, so a little bit of background about how radio works. So we have a broadcasting tower that just broadcasts a message. And that broadcast is sent to what they call repeaters. And what a repeater does is basically just take that signal that it receives and then repeat it forward. And that's, you know, technically can go on forever, infinite. And you can hijack that by essentially broadcasting at a higher, more powerful rate than the actual broadcasting tower. Because there's no authentication between you and the repeater, if you just broadcast over another signal, you can theoretically hijack that repeater and have your message broadcast to, you know, tons and tons of other locations and stuff like that. Shit, I don't have audio. Is there audio here? Like an audio cable?
Well, it's HDMI, so let's hope so.
Okay. Let's see if that works. Oh, it might be muted. Sorry, wrong one. Sorry, we will mute that for a bit. By the way, in the spirit of Halloween, all of these signal hijackings have a little bit of terror to them, a little bit of scariness, so you've been warned. We'll just skip by all this annoying sound. I think it's...
On the 21st, 1988, Barry Valentino, son of Barry Senior Dean, brother Scott Martin, Lisa Ann's friend and my friend. February 1985, Frank Oppenheimer, brother Robert Hilton, Jackie Emily, father Michael, our friend.
I don't know if you can hear it very well, but essentially what this voice is doing is broadcasting a list of deceased people and when they died and how they died. So this was broadcast to an entire city of people, so it's a little bit terrifying. And this is back in 1995. This one is perhaps truly terrifying. This was a TV hijacking that occurred where both the audio and the video was hijacked.
That is the only way to learn.
This was during a Doctor Who episode.
He's a freaking nerd. He's like, I think I'm better than Chuck Swirsky. Freaking the fool. Oh, Jesus.
I'll pause it there because it proceeds to get more and more X-rated as it goes. There is some male nudity as well, so I will save you guys from that. But yeah, so this guy has never been caught either. So nobody knows who this guy is, why he did this, or whatever. But to you guys who don't know, because I didn't even know who this guy was, but the hijacker is basing this off of a child's cartoon called Max Headroom that occurred on TV quite a while ago. And apparently it looks just like this. So, you know, that's kind of even more terrifying when this was a kid's character that they modeled it off there. Pardon me?
I remember
that. That's, yeah, was it as creepy as that?
No, it's more of like an MTV type kind of synthetic character.
Okay. There you go. So this is based off of a real thing that this guy was doing. Yeah, this one was particularly good, primarily because they only targeted the audio here. They kept the video intact, which almost makes it even more terrifying.
Civil authorities in your area have reported that the bodies of the dead are rising from their graves and attacking the living. Follow the messages on screen that will be updated as information becomes available. Do not attempt to approach or apprehend these bodies as they are considered extremely dangerous.
So yeah, that's terrifying. And yeah, I don't think they caught these guys either. So these people are all, you know, still out there and in large. Back, I think a couple months back even, there was an incident like this happening in Hamilton, where some signal hijackers are basically taking over Hamilton radio station and playing like a very perverted song over and over and over again. So this stuff is still happening today, just in remote areas. So yeah, it's still relevant. And how about your local security testing as well? Obviously we have the IoT guys in the room, so you know, you can hack IoT devices with radio as well, Furbies as well. The car hacking is particularly interesting. So there was two kind of major attacks targeted towards cars. The one is a replay attack. So essentially what the attacker will do is, using radio technology, they will capture what's broadcasting from one of those keys that are completely keyless, you know, where you don't actually have to plug your key into the car to turn it on. So basically they capture that broadcast and just replay it to the car, which thinks the key is near, and then it allows you to unlock the doors, turn on the car, drive away, you know, things like that. The second major attack is an amplification attack. So again, targeting these keyless entry vehicles. Say you're sitting on your couch, what the attacker will do is basically act as a repeater and try to get that signal from your key to be broadcast to a greater distance, allowing you to unlock the car, steal the contents inside, stuff like that. So these are legitimate attack vectors. They demonstrated a lot of these at DEF CON this year, if any of you guys went to that. On top of that, there are wireless attacks against garages or garage doors. Sammy Camcar, which is a very popular name out there, has actually released an open source product called Open Sesame. And its design was to attack garage doors and things of that nature. So that's pretty terrifying when an attacker can basically break into your house, break into your cars, you know, all through leveraging wireless radio and things like that. Anybody know what that is in the bottom right-hand corner? Pacemaker? Yeah, it's a pretty good guess. I don't know the exact terminology, but basically, yeah, you're right. It's it regulates the heartbeat. For patients, and yes, it's susceptible to attacks with radio and stuff like that. Additionally, there was a DEF CON 25 video that just dropped last night where researchers were using radio signals to fuzz home security systems, ones that, you know, monitor for, you know, break-ins and stuff like that. I haven't seen the video yet, but it looks very interesting. So yeah, just another vector of attack in a lot of these situations. All right, so say you're interested in ham radio. How do you get started in this? Well, you can do what I do and just buy the books. Because they are Canadian materials, you might have a hard time finding these for download for free online. Not saying that I tried to do this, but I'm just saying that if you were to look for them, you probably won't find them. The green book over here, it's more of a textbook, more of an A to Z, learning how to, yeah, it's,
that's
yeah.
Good.
No, she was just making fun of me that I was pointing at the, you know. Okay, sorry, I'll arch my back more. Target. Okay, so the green book is more of a textbook, like an A to Z. It'll teach you everything you need to know from, you know, assuming that you know nothing about radio. The red book is more of a study guide, which just has the questions and the answers for the exam that you're going to take. So how about equipment? The Baofeng is one of the best starter units you can buy. It is a little pricey, but understand that if you're buying this, you probably won't need to buy one again. They're extremely durable. I bought them before the shipping went to an extremely high price. I don't know why that is, but yeah, it's a good model to check out.
You can get them from $30 from China, free shipping, if you're willing to wait the 2 months.
Yeah. He has manufacturing knowledge.
I have them right here. This is the Baofeng.
Oh, you just came here to sell your wares, okay. do you have software-defined radios as well?
No.
No? Okay. So I actually bought one. It's a new Elec, and it's kind of a piece of shit because I couldn't get it to work because I was planning on implementing a demo for you guys, but basically the drivers weren't detecting on here, so they weren't working on my Windows or Linux boxes, so I was like, well, at least I can bring it in and show you guys. But this is not that. This was just the cheapest one I could find on Amazon. The software-defined radio here on the presentation is from the Hack Shop, which is Hack 5, the makers of the Wi-Fi Pineapple and things like that. So they're a little bit more reputable than just any seller on Amazon. And so again, when you're joining ham radio and you want to get involved, the best place to do that is to find a local club. They have local clubs absolutely everywhere. I didn't check, but there's probably one in Oakville. I had a little bit of a bad experience with my local chapter, so I reached out to them, said that I was interested in joining. You know, I was super pumped. They gave me a date to come. I said that I couldn't make it, and I said, you know, like maybe give me another date, like the next time they're hosting their club meeting, and they just never responded to me. So they just completely ghosted me, and yeah, I felt a little bit hurt there. Yeah, it was a little bit weird. So yeah, the whole point of joining a club as well is that oftentimes the people that come to the clubs as well can't examine you. They can give you the exam to get your ham license. So that was my idea, was to join a club to get my license. So hey Adam, what's your call sign? What's your license? Unfortunately, I never got one just because the timings didn't work out. You're probably asking me why I'm giving this presentation to begin with. Well, I was going to wait till I got this to give the presentation, but then I'm like, well, that might never happen, so no, I'm joking. But yeah, you guys know where this meme is from? Yeah, 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 I'm hip and cool, guys. Yeah, no worries. Also, I just want to give a quick PSA. So I don't normally do this, but you know, I just fell in love with this TV show, and it's like completely unknown. Not many people know about it, but it's completely made and filmed in Toronto, and it's, you know, it's absolutely hilarious. One of my favorite shows, so you guys should all go check it out. Absolutely fantastic. Okay, completely random, I know, but I was like, you know what? I just, like, this show is so unknown that just telling, like, the people in the room would give it enough exposure to maybe make it big somewhere. So that's my giving back to the show. So that's it. That's all my time here. Do you have any questions? If you want to reach out to me, my LinkedIn, my Twitter, I don't browse any of those, but if you direct message me, I will respond. So yeah, any questions? Any comments even? I'll take that. Tavish?
Are there commercial licenses that companies need to get?
Yeah, yeah. So you, as a lone person, can't screw around with any of the commercial frequencies. That's super illegal. That's what I tried to emphasize earlier in the presentation.
Yes, but like if a new startup is going on, when they're getting a license and so on, are they getting it on the commercial frequency? And if so, would that creatively reduce the amp frequency, right?
So I imagine if you are a radio company and you want to actually create like a radio, like host station or whatever, you probably have to go and register your frequency. Like,
you
if you're.
Bid on frequencies.
Oh, there you go. You have to bid on them.
Bids happen, I think, every 2 years for new frequency allotments. And what about the frequencies when you're talking about, like, the remote cars and
like
how.
Like trucks and.
So you're like, what do you mean? Like the radios in the car or?
Well, the key.
The key. I mean, those are local. Like those are local frequencies, so they don't really like matter, right? Because it's like Bluetooth. It's only in your like near vicinity, so you don't really have to register that because, you know, stuff like that. Oh, do you have like? Okay. We can try, yeah.
Is that the guy who has access?
If you don't have a hand license and then somebody hears you doing something you shouldn't be, what do they say? Get off the air and you say, yeah.
Well, okay, so one of the games you can play as, you know, with ham technology is called fox catching. And essentially what it is, you know, people use their radio technology to, like, triangulate where signals are coming from. So they do this for fun. So if you're broadcasting, they will, for fun, come triangulate you and find you and hunt you down. But, you know, No, I'm not even kidding. Like, people just do this for fun because they have a lot of time on their hands. But,
Do you have to be licensed in order to use
radio? Yes. So there's. So that's the thing, right? You know, you can lie, but if anybody catches you in a lie, yeah. So here we go. All right, so we have a working demo. crazy. The chances of this were crazy, but essentially, Dave's computer had the drivers installed here, and so we're currently listening to, well, just 102.1
rock radio.
Yeah. There you go.
This month we get two meteor showers, the Draconids and the Orionids. The Orionids are peaking tonight, and best time to look up to the sky near Orion is just after midnight. Go check out the tail of Halley's Comet.
Yeah. So it's not illegal to receive, because obviously that would make every car in the world, you know, susceptible to that. So you're okay to listen, and if you have a life-threatening incident, you're allowed to broadcast. So that is the only incident where, you know, they will not come after you, is if you need help and you're broadcasting, then you're good. But, pardon me? Yeah, if you need help, yeah. You want them to come after you, exactly. If you're lying about needing help and they come after you, you know, they come find you, then you're doubly in trouble. So, yeah, be careful out there. Any other questions? Oh yeah, the HackRF is also like $300, so. No, Proxmark, I think, is total. Yeah. Like, Proxmark is to be used to, like, clone badges and stuff like that. Yeah. Pardon me? So I don't think, as Dave said, I don't think these actually do translate. you know, actually do the broadcasting. Well, I guess it would just be anything powerful enough to reach this. So if you have a gigantic, you know, broadcasting station with tons of repeaters, you know, technically you could get something from, you know, even across the ocean. In fact, that's a common thing that ham radio operators do as well, is try to communicate across the world. Because basically you can leverage like physics and the way that the wave bounces through the clouds to travel over a long distance, like across Canada or even the world. So yeah, it's quite amazing. yeah, there's a lot of environmental things you have to consider, but yeah, aside from that. Yeah. Alright, I think we're good. I think we're good. Yeah. Thank you.
Alright, I just remembered. So with the bow fangs, you can program them to do certain things, but if you were to just break into the firmware and just like reflash it, could you be able to do something with it?
To be honest, I've never tried to do anything like that.
I have like the cables to like program it so that you can have like special frequencies and modes that you want.
Yeah. Like you can basically program in like hard code in the channels that you want to use.
Yeah.
Or receive on or whatever. But I haven't looked at anything with flashing firmware.
So if someone did, you know, like rewrote the firmware to do malicious things, then you would have like a cheap radio that can transmit.
I think I can transmit though.
Yeah, like it can transmit now, but like to go into frequencies it can't. It's not allowed.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, might be able to. Yeah, that's cool.
Thanks for coming down. Sorry, I couldn't get you a busier week, but
it's all good, man. You do what you got to do, right?